fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face. But until that day, we'll hold on to you always.
Yeah, so Gomer did absolutely everything for him. He wouldn't let him do anything himself because he loved him so much and he was so thankful for what he had did that he was just constantly trying to do something for him. So he mowed the lawn, he would chop the firewood, he would wash the windows, and on and on and on. And he did this not out of obligation, but out of love and gratitude for the man who had saved his life. You see, anytime somebody does something really special for us, and that rises even the level of saving our lives, it changes the way we interact with that person. It changes our relationship with them. When somebody does something that special, it just changes things. And the idea that things change when somebody does something that special for us is the basis for three commands that the writer of Hebrews gives us in Hebrews chapter 10. So if you will turn with me to Hebrews chapter 10, I'll be reading verses 19 through 25. And as we look at these three commands that he gives us, just understand that our obedience is not out of obligation, but instead out of the great work that Christ has done for us. And so I'll begin reading in verse 19 of chapter 10 of the book of Hebrews. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he consecrated for us, through the veil that is his flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Let's pray. Father, I just pray that you would speak through me today, Lord, that you would help us to understand this passage, and you would help us to apply it to our lives. I pray that your Spirit will move through this place this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now before we look at these three specific commands of drawing near, of holding fast, and of considering one another, it's important to set this in the context of the rest of the book of Hebrews. Hebrews is a book that was written, or a letter that was written, to a group of Jewish Christians. And the theme of the book is that Jesus is greater, that he is superior to all the things in the Old Testament that were pointing forward towards him. And it's important whenever we study the book of Hebrews to approach it almost like a sermon. And so the writer would go back and forth in which he would teach something about who Jesus was and what he has done for us, and then he would apply it to his readers, similar to how a pastor will make a point and then apply it to his people. And so as we look at this passage, I want to take a step back and work through just very briefly the preceding chapters that leads up to this. Because when we do that, we see that our obedience is, again, not out of obligation to Christ, but out of a response to the great work that he has done for us. And so if we'll back up just briefly to chapter 7, what we see starting in chapter 7 is that Jesus is a greater priest than all the priests of the Old Testament. It says in verse 16 of chapter 7, Jesus, who has come not according to the law of a fleshly commandment, but according to the power of an endless life. All the priests of the Old Testament were priests not because of their character, but simply because they were from the family of Aaron, of the tribe of Levi. But Jesus stands as a priest not based on a fleshly commandment or his family name, but on the power of an endless life. Later in Hebrews, it talks about how the priests, there were numerous priests because they kept dying. You'd have one and then he would die and then you'd have to replace him. But Jesus is the one who is greater than all the others because he is the priest who reigns forever. Then in chapter 8, we see that Jesus' covenant that he brings into being with his work on the cross is greater than the Old Testament covenant that the Israelites entered into at Mount Sinai. Then in chapter 9, we see that Jesus entered into the heavenly tabernacle, not the one that's built with earthly hands, but a greater tabernacle. And if you've been with us here on Wednesday nights over the past few weeks, you know that both the youth and the adults have talked a lot about the tabernacle. And really, to understand this portion of the book of Hebrews, an understanding of the tabernacle is very, very important. You see, the tabernacle was a place where God dwelled among his people. There were two parts to the tabernacle. The first part, the holy place, was the place that the priests went in to offer their daily offerings and sacrifices. And the back part of the tabernacle, the most holy place, or the Holy of Holies, was the place that the Ark of the Covenant resided. And this was a place that God's presence was especially manifested. And so the tabernacle was a symbol of God's presence amongst his people. But Jesus has entered into a heavenly tabernacle. And so what we see is that the tabernacle that he has entered into brings us into a greater experience of God's presence and a greater relationship with God than the earthly tabernacle ever could do. I talk about this, and I do want to take just a moment to encourage you. If you ever have the opportunity to be here on Wednesday nights, I would really encourage you to do that. Scott is going through a Bible study book by book on Wednesday nights, and it is amazing to me how much this book, the more I read it from cover to cover, the more it amazes me how much it all fits together. It's amazing that the things we've talked about, both with the adults and the youth over the past few weeks, from the books of Exodus and Leviticus, how much those things fit together with what the writer of Hebrews talks about 1,500 years later. And so sometimes it's hard for us to see how all of this fits together. And that's why his Bible study would be so helpful. Because as you go book by book, it really begins to help you to see that there's this much greater, bigger picture to the Bible. And it truly is the most beautiful story that has ever been told. And so if you ever have the opportunity to be here, it would be so beneficial for you as you just walk through the Bible book by book and you see how this all fits together. So again, we've seen that Jesus is the greater priest. We've seen that his covenant is greater. And we've seen that he has entered into a greater tabernacle. And then at the end of chapter 9 and the beginning of chapter 10, we see that his sacrifice is better than all of the Old Testament sacrifices that were ever offered. You know, the Old Testament is filled with sacrifice after sacrifice after sacrifice. But Jesus' sacrifice is greater than all of them put together. So if you look in chapter 10, starting at verse 11, the problem with the Old Testament sacrifices is they didn't actually fix the sin problem. It didn't fix the sinfulness of the human heart. And so look, starting at verse 11 in chapter 10, what this says. It says, "And every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God, from that time waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. For by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. But the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us. For after he had said before, 'This is a covenant that I will make with them after those days,' says the Lord, 'I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds I will write them.' Then he adds this, 'Their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more.' Now, where there's remission of these, there is no longer an offering of sin." Jesus' sacrifice did what the Old Testament sacrifices could not do. He fixed the problem of sin. And then look at the beginning of verse 9. It starts with "therefore." So in other words, in light of all the things that we've already talked about, in light of the fact that Jesus is the greater priest, that his covenant is greater, that his tabernacle is greater, in light of the fact that his sacrifice is greater, and that his sacrifice is the one who has been sufficient to take care of the sin problem. In light of all of that, we come to these three commands in Hebrews of let us draw near, let us hold fast, and let us consider one another. And so as we look at this paragraph, these first three verses, 19, 20, and 21, point us back to all the things that we've already been talking about. They point us back to the sacrifice of Christ. And so let's look through those. This verse 19, it says, "Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus." This is talking about that holy of holies, that most holy place where God's presence dwelt. And you see, this was a place that even the bravest of people would never want to go inside. Because it was into the holy of holies that only one guy, one time a year, would go there. And it was the high priest. And as we looked at in Leviticus on Wednesday nights with the youth, there were very specific commands that the high priest had to follow in order to enter into that presence. And if he didn't, then he was struck dead. If anybody approached God's presence in the Holy of Holies, in an unworthy way. They were struck dead. And yet here we are being offered, thanks to the work of Christ, we are being offered an opportunity to go into the Holy of Holies with boldness and confidence. We do this because we have this new and this living way, which is Christ himself. See, it talks about there in verse 20, by a new and living way, which he consecrated for us through the veil that is his flesh. You see, what divided the holy place from the most holy place was a curtain or a veil. And in order to go into the presence of God, the high priest would have to pass through that veil. But you see, when Jesus was crucified, that veil was miraculously torn from top to bottom, showing us that the separation between God and his people had forever been bridged. And so now, instead of passing through a veil or a curtain to go into the Holy of Holies and to be in relationship in the presence of God, we instead go through the work of Christ and his sacrifice. In verse 21 it says, and also we have a high priest over the house of God. Literally here, there's actually a word in the Greek that is used for high priest, and the writer of Hebrews doesn't use that here. Instead he just says, the greater priest. We have a priest that is greater than any other priest that has ever walked on the face of the earth. And he is not just a part of God's house, but is actually the one who is over God's house. And what's wonderful is we have this great priest who now is in the Holy of Holies in heaven. And he's there for us. He's there as an advocate for us. Look in chapter 9, verse 24. It says, for Christ has not entered the holy place made with hands, which are copies of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Right now in heaven, Jesus Christ stands in the Holy of Holies, advocating on our behalf, representing us. And so in light of all of these things, again, we're obedient to Christ, not out of obligation, but out of love and gratitude. We're obedient to him, not in an effort to somehow gain God's favor, but precisely because we already have God's love and favor. You know, I'm always amazed that people, and it always makes me so sad when I see people who have grown up in church and have heard the gospel and have heard the Bible preached and taught, and yet they have a complete just misunderstanding about the message of Christianity. You know, it's true that we as Christians have things that we are supposed to do and things that we are not supposed to do. But Christianity is not a long list just of thou shalt not. It's so much more than that. We respond in obedience to God, again, out of our love and gratitude for what it is that he has done. That he has opened up the possibility to have relationship with God to us. And because of that, we respond in obedience to him. You see, we were bought, we were redeemed with the most expensive price in the history of everything. We were bought, we were redeemed, we were brought into relationship with God with the blood of God himself. 1 Peter talks about it, 1 Peter 1:18, that we weren't bought with corruptible things like silver or gold, you know, worthless things like that. But instead, we were bought with the precious blood of Jesus as a precious lamb without spot. And so in light of that, in light of the fact of what has been paid for us, in light of the great work that has taken place for us, that has opened up to us a relationship with God, in light of all those things, we now come to these three commands and we're obedient to them. How can we not be obedient? Knowing what has been paid for us, knowing what has been done for us, how can we not? We owe him everything. We owe him our lives, our existence, our eternal futures. How can we not be obedient to him? And so in light of all of that, let's now look at the first of the three commands that the writer of Hebrews gives us. Look at verse 22. Let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Jesus has opened up to us a relationship with God that the Jews never, ever could have even imagined. He has opened up to us the very presence of God. This is truly the greatest invitation that anybody has ever received. We are being invited into the Holy of Holies, the place that, again, no one could have even imagined going in an unworthy way. And yet we are being invited into that presence. I want you to stop and just think for a minute about what would be the greatest possible invitation that you could receive on this earth? That one event, that one party, that one whatever that you just would made, if I could just be invited to that, that would be really cool. I know for me, the probably the greatest invitation I could possibly receive is if Adrian Beltre personally invited me to take batting practice with the Raiders before Game 7 of the World Series. Like, that would be the best possible thing. For others of you, it may be to go backstage with your favorite, you know, band or singer before a concert. Or to be on the set of your favorite TV show, or be invited to the Oscars or the White House. And while all those things would be cool, and it would be understandable for us to be excited about that, the reality is the invitation we are being offered here in verse 22 of let us draw near to God to be in His presence is so much greater and so much better than any earthly invitation we could ever possibly receive. We are being invited again into the presence of God. How do we do this? We do this by putting God first and foremost over everything else. You know, this is not just we do a morning prayer time and a morning devotional, and then we go through the rest of the day not really thinking much about it. No, this is putting Him first and above everything else. We are seeking Him above all else as we draw near to Him. And we can do this because our hearts have been made pure. We have a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. You see, that was the problem. Nobody could approach God with the sin in their heart. This was the reason why they had to continually offer sacrifices in the Old Testament. It was to temporarily purify them enough just so the one guy could go in there the one time a year. But the problem is, even then, there was this great separation. And so that is what separates us from God. But that is precisely what Jesus has come to fix. And so this reference to our bodies being washed, it's not a reference, I don't think, to baptism. Instead, I think it's the writer of Hebrews' way of pointing us back again to the supreme sacrifice that Christ made. To the work that He did that was greater than all the work done in the Old Testament. So look back in chapter 9, starting in verse 9. I want to show you just a little bit here. It says it was symbolic, talking about all the things that had been offered in the Old Testament, all the sacrifices. It was symbolic for the present time in which both gifts and sacrifices are offered, which cannot make him who performed the service perfect in regard to the conscience. You see, that is God's standard of perfection. And all the Old Testament sacrifices were offered could not make anyone perfect. Then skip down to verse 13 of chapter 9. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer, sprinkling the unclean, sanctifies for the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? See, all those Old Testament sacrifices, the most they could do is to temporarily kind of purify the body, the flesh. But they had no hope of digging into the human heart, which was the root of the problem. But Jesus, again, whose sacrifice is greater, was able to go to the root cause of our problems, the sinfulness of the human heart. And He has washed that clean. And look, verse 1 of chapter 10. For the law, having a shadow of the good things to come, and not the very image of those things, can never with these same sacrifices, which they continually offer year by year, make those who approach perfect. And so they had to continue offering sacrifice after sacrifice after sacrifice, precisely because it didn't actually fix the problem. And even let's say for a minute that the sacrifices could fix their sin that they had committed previously, the problem is they would then commit another sin, which would mean they would need another sacrifice. And they would sin again, and they would need another sacrifice, and on and on and on. But the wonderful thing is here, as we see in this passage in Hebrews 10, is that the verb tense in the Greek is the perfect tense. And the reason why that's important is because that indicates a past action that has ongoing significance into the future. You see, Jesus offered himself up one time, and it was sufficient to deal with all sin that would ever be committed by those who believe in him. It wasn't something that had to continue to be offered again and again. Jesus' sacrifice is not needed again. We don't have to make some other sacrifice to atone for our sins, because the one sacrifice, the one time, 2,000 years ago, was sufficient for us. And even when we still occasionally mess up and sin, that sacrifice is sufficient. to cover any sins that we would make. And so in light of this, again, we draw near to God. In light of the fact that our sin problem has been fixed, we draw near to the presence of God. We accept this great, great invitation. The second thing he tells us to do is to hold fast. Look at verse 23. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. We hold on to our faith. We hold on to that which we're confessing about Jesus. We hold on to that relationship. Now that we've been brought into this intimate relationship with God, we hold on to that relationship. And that means even during difficult times. Living a Christian lifestyle is not easy in our world today. You know, saying that this is the inspired word of God, that Jesus was the Son of God who lived, died, and rose again, those things aren't popular. And it's not easy to take that bold stand in our world today. But nonetheless, that's why it's so important that we make the commitment that we're going to hold fast, that we're going to hold on tightly to our confession and our faith. And it's important to understand that even though the Christian worldview may not be popular in America today, and even though it may be under attack in some sense, it's not a physical attack. And hopefully won't be any time in the future. But that's not the case for early Christians. Early Christians, if they were found out to be Christians, could potentially suffer the loss of their homes and reputation, suffer physical violence, or even death at the hands of the Jews or the Romans. And so if people who had a greater likelihood of facing violence or death were told to hold on tightly to their faith, how much more should Christians living in America today hold on tightly to our faith and our relationship with God? And it says not only are we supposed to hold on to it, we're supposed to do it without wavering. And this literally means that which does not bend. We hold on completely resolute, completely immovable in our faith, not budging even slightly. That's how desperately and strongly we cling and hold on to our faith. And the basis for this, notice the end of verse 23 there, is because for he who promised is faithful. We can be faithful to him because we know he is faithful to us. This is a really important theme in the book of Hebrews, that especially you see in Hebrews chapter 11 of the Hall of Faith, that all of those great Old Testament saints trusted that God would be faithful to fulfill his promises. And God always did. We can have confidence knowing that what God has promised to us will come true because our God is faithful. And so God in the New Testament makes many promises to believers in Christ. He promises us in Romans 8:28 that he'll work all things together for our good. He promises us that he will come back for us, that we will reign with him, that we will be co-heirs with Christ. And again, because he who promised these things is faithful, we can have confidence that these things will come true. So how can we possibly walk away from that, knowing that those things that have been promised to us will come true because he who promised those things are faithful? So we draw near to God in relationship with him. We hold on tightly to that. But not only has Christ's sacrifice opened up to us a relationship with God, but he's also opened up an intimate relationship with fellow believers as well. And so the third command we see here is to consider one another. Look at verse 24. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. All right, so we have this one command to consider one another for the purpose of stirring up love and good works. And then in verse 25, he gives us two ways that we can do that. And we'll talk about that in a moment. But first, let's just talk about this one command, to consider one another. This has the idea of deeply considering, deeply being concerned for your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. This is not a passing, entertaining thought you have for a moment and then it passes away. But a deep concern for the well-being of your brothers and sisters in Christ. So let me ask you, how often do you honestly think about your brothers and sisters in Christ and their spiritual well-being? How often do you think about the people you gather with every Sunday to worship God? How often do you truly think about their spiritual growth and their spiritual maturity? Because we're called to consider one another. We're called to be deeply concerned with one another. And again, we do it for the purpose of stirring up love and good works. In other words, we do it for the purpose of helping people grow in their relationship with the Lord. What's interesting here is the word used for stir up is a very, very kind of negative word. In fact, it's usually used in the connotation of annoying or agitating somebody. Now, let me be clear. This is not a biblical command to annoy the person sitting in the pew next to you, okay? That's not what this says. But there is a biblical command here to be deeply involved in the lives of our fellow believers, to be there for them when they need us, to spur them on, again, to stir them up in order to help them grow in the relationship with the Lord. Now, I don't think every believer can possibly be this involved with every other believer. So that means probably it's not a good idea if it's somebody you don't know their name and you've never really spoken to them. Probably not a good idea to go up to them and give them unsolicited advice. All right? That's not what this is saying. We're not called to be pot stirrers who are always involved in everybody else's business all the time, just always kind of the busybody type thing. But what this is saying is that we need to have people in our lives that we are deeply involved with for the purpose, again, of helping them grow in their relationship with the Lord and for them to help us grow in our relationship with the Lord. So what this command is the idea that we are deeply involved in the lives of fellow believers for the purpose of mutually stirring each other up to love and good works and to help each other grow in our relationship with the Lord. So how do we do this? Well, there's two specific things that he gives us in verse 25, a negative and then a positive. Look at verse 25. It says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. So the first command is to not forsake the gathering of ourselves together. In other words, the idea is that we need to consistently be involved and plugged in with other believers in Christ. Now, earlier I talked about how it would be good if any of you are available to come on Wednesday night. And I still say that. But this command is not a command to be in the church every time the doors are open. I've heard some people who try to say that. But what this is saying is that every believer needs to consistently be plugged in and involved in church with fellow believers. And again, the reason why this is so important is because it is the means by which we grow in our relationship with the Lord, is we're plugged in and we're connected and we're concerned with and considering our fellow believers. And so this is an important thing. And trust me, I understand that in this world today, it's difficult to sometimes consistently make a point at being a church. I mean, we're all being pulled in five different directions, and it's hard to keep everything straight. But what's interesting is, even though it may be easy to kind of fall out of the habit of consistently being plugged in with fellow believers, apparently that was also the case 2,000 years ago, because notice verse 25, it says that it was the manner of some, even back then, to forsake the assembly together with each other. And so the reality is, no matter what you have going on in your life, the reality is, Satan is always going to put things in your life that will distract you from gathering with other believers. No matter what stage of life you're in, no matter what you have going on in your life, Satan is always going to put things in your life that will prevent you from gathering together. And that's the reason why it's so important that we make it a point to consistently gather with fellow believers. For again, for the purpose of stirring up love and good works. You know, in America today, we have kind of this concept that we have for a long time of kind of the self-made man, this rugged individualism. And those, to an extent, could be a good thing. The idea of taking care of yourself and not relying on somebody else to do everything for you, that's good. But it can be taken too far. Because the reality is, there's no such thing as a self-made man. And rugged individualism is not biblical. We were created as relational beings, and we desire and need relationship with other people in order to grow. We desire and need relationship with God first and foremost, but we also need our relationship with fellow believers, and that's why we're being called to consider one another here. And the second thing, after he tells us to not forsake assembly together, the second thing he tells us to do is to exhort one another or encourage one another. And the word used here literally means to go alongside. So this is not the idea of somebody sitting on the sidelines kind of just randomly throwing some advice in every now and again. But this is somebody who's going alongside with that person, who is going along through the trials and tribulations of life, who is there to weep with them when they weep and there to rejoice with them when they rejoice. This is the idea of the type of fellowship that is supposed to exist within brothers and sisters in Christ in the local church. And so we don't forsake assembly together, and we exhort and encourage one another. Now, I've heard some people say that I love Jesus. I'm all for Jesus. He's great, but I don't really care for the church that much. I don't really care really that much for other Christians. Yeah, like I said, give me Jesus, hey, that's great, I'll do my own thing, but just don't really want to do the whole church thing. Let me be clear, you cannot love Jesus Christ and not love his bride, the church. It is for the church that all the things that we have talked about today, all the great work that Jesus has done for us, it was for the church. It was to redeem a people back to himself. It was for the church, his bride, that he laid down his life. So you can't say, oh, I love Jesus, I just don't love the thing that's most important to Jesus. All right? You can't say, I love Jesus, but not be concerned with the church. And so we are invited to have a relationship with God. Yes, that's what we're being invited to in this passage. Have a relationship with God, being his presence. And secondly, we're also being invited to have fellowship and relationship with fellow believers. And so as we look back at all the things that Jesus has done for us, the fact that he is the greater priest, that his covenant is better, that the tabernacle he has is the heavenly tabernacle, the fact that his sacrifice is better, the fact that his sacrifice is the one that has fixed our guilty hearts and our sinful hearts. In light of all that, we follow these three commands. We approach God, and we can approach God with boldness. We're invited to enjoy that relationship, to hold on to it tightly, and also to enjoy our relationship with fellow believers as we build them up in Christ. So it's my hope and my prayer that this is something that we do here at First Baptist Mesquite. And it's my hope and my prayer that everybody here this morning will take the opportunity to enjoy the relationship that is offered to us and draw near to him this morning. To hold on to that and to consider one another for the purpose of stirring up love and good works. Let's pray.